Now, Dan is the man in Sarnia. This guy flips houses like a beast.
My strategy for the last 5 years has been flipping houses, but I started out just doing buy and holds. I was doing the BRRRR strategy before I knew what a BRRRR was. So I think one of the most important things that you have to learn is what is a deal.
Yeah.
I think that's because nothing happens until you have a deal. No matter what strategy, they all have pros and cons. Yep. And I would figure out what the pros and cons of each strategy are, and you're gonna sort of have a feeling, a gut feeling of what you'd probably, what direction you'd like to go.
Yep.
Go all in on that one thing and see how you do. And get it out of your head that the people are gonna take advantage of you, or all these little stories that you hear. There's more people that want to help you than want to take your deal. At 35, I went, oh my God, I got to do something with my life. What am I do now? And then I got into real estate, and thank God I did, right? It changed my life.
In today's video, Adam Martin from my team sits down with Dan Desveaux and just catches up with him. What's going on in the Sarnia real estate market? What's Dan doing these days? And really just how has he grown to this level of success he has as a real estate investor? You guys may remember Dan Desveaux. He was the very first guest I think I ever had on my YouTube channel where we ran down his water slides. He used to own an old abandoned water park, but I think now that's been converted into beach volleyball and axe throwing. Yeah, Dan's got some really cool investments and some really cool real estate. He also owns a building that contains a brewery. All kinds of neat stuff coming from Dan Desveaux. Let's catch up with him.
What's up, YouTube? I'm here today in Sarnia, Ontario, and we're going to be talking to Dan Desveaux. Now, Dan is the man in Sarnia. This guy flips houses like a beast, and he's going to walk us through a bunch of his projects. But first, we're sitting here today for a quick interview right in his brand new renovated mansion. So here's Dan, everybody. Dan, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hey, everybody. Thanks, Adam. Appreciate you having me on your show. My name is Dan Desveaux. I'm in Sarnia, Ontario here in my house. And my strategy for the last 5 years has been flipping houses, but I started out just doing buy and holds. I was doing the BRRRR strategy before I knew what a BRRRR was. I did about 10 to 15 BRRRRs. Which is buy, renovate, refinance, repeat. Some people have different versions of that, but that's what the BRRRR was when I started out. And I did BRRRRs for the first 10 years, built up a decent sized portfolio, and then I thought, because I had a construction background, I thought I'll get back I'll start flipping houses. Turns out flipping houses is not for the faint of heart. I had a lot of ups and downs in the last 4 or 5 years, mostly ups, which is good. And currently I have five flips on the go here in Sarnia. It's a great market for flipping houses. You can still get them pretty cheap. And it's still pretty good profit margins. I know in from London to whatever past Toronto there, it's getting pretty tough to do flips nowadays. There's still some out there, but Sarnia is still a cheap market. I mean, the difference here is buy cheap, sell cheap, right? So that's kind of what we're doing. So you have to do large quantities. We're in Toronto, you know, you're spending a lot of money, but you potential to make a lot of money there as well. But anyway, that's what I'm doing now, and I'm finally getting the hang of it, which is great. Starting to see some good returns, and Sarnia market is actually great. We've seen it's up about 10-15% since last year. So pretty good appreciation. My portfolio has gone up, and you know, like I said, I'm starting to get a handle on the flips, and it's going well. And that's what's going on with me.
I love that. So today we're actually going to walk through some of Dan's projects, and he actually has 5 flips on the go. I've been driving myself crazy personally over one flip over the last few months and just ignoring the other 4 that I need to be flipping at the same time. So I think Dan's gonna have some great tips for us on how to actually manage that amount of work and then make it all execute while he's sitting here in the kitchen hanging out with us.
So I wanted to start a renovation business. That was, you know, when I got out of university, couldn't get a job. I went to university to be a teacher. And when I got out of there, I couldn't get a teaching job. So I was actually quite lucky that I didn't get a teaching job. It wasn't what I was supposed to do anyway. So in the summers I was doing construction. So I thought, okay, well, I'll start my own business. Turns out starting your own business is very difficult. So I ended up, what happens to a lot of entrepreneur wannabes is they end up just either going back to work for somebody or they become a subcontractor.
Yeah.
And that's sort of what I did. So basically someone's feeding you the work.
Yeah.
Right? And but you're technically self-employed.
So I you still have all the downfalls of self-employed, like you're...
Yeah, well, the good part about the you know, you pay a lot less tax,
yeah,
right? But the bad part is all the other stuff that comes with that being self-employed, right?
Yeah.
You have to look after yourself, where you not just have a paycheck coming in whether you show up or not. You
yeah.
actually have to get out of bed every day and go to work.
Yeah.
Right. But you're not having to look for the work, but it's all that same stuff is there. I'd say there's more pros than cons being self-employed, for sure.
For sure. Why do you keep going?
Because it's fun. What else are you going to do?
Right.
Right? Yeah.
Like it. It's not about the money, is it?
I think it's a little bit of both,
yeah.
Right? You know, you want to, I think you want to be successful. It's got to be about the money, right? You know, you have to have something, you're I mean, it's a bunch of reasons, but certainly money is one of them. But you got to love what you do because you have to be able to get out of bed in the morning. It's going to be a challenge no matter what you do.
Yeah.
I think it's a challenge if you're poor and if it's a challenge if you're wealthy. So why not be wealthy?
It's a really big challenge if you're poor.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, so just get out there and do it.
Yeah, love it. I think the best video here is for what would you give advice to these younger guys? I think it's interesting that you were talking about having to have a job or whether you have a job or not.
Yeah, well, when I started, I had a job, and even though I wasn't making very much money, I had to save up for years and then buy your first property, and then you save up for another a couple of years, and then you get another property. Whereas nowadays, with all the private money, I think the big thing is access to information.
Yeah.
Right? Like back when I started, like the internet was just starting. It's, you know, it's kind of crazy to even say.
But it makes a lot of sense. Like, how did you even find out initially that, like, this was an option? Because like we had YouTube videos, the books,
yeah,
right? Like we had Rich Dad, Poor Dad, we had
yeah.
every Matt McKeever and Bigger Pockets in the world out there telling you what to do.
Like, well, we had to send away for stuff. You know, there was, well, when I first got started, I watched an infomercial on TV, this guy named Tom Vu. If anybody's heard me talk before, they talk about this story about Tom Vu. So it was an infomercial on TV, and I had to send away, I actually didn't get Tom Vu stuff, I got, what was it, Carlton Sheets was the guy's
okay.
name, and he was just an American guru real estate guy, and I got his, it was a binder, it was a big fat binder, and you had to read through it. So, you know, like I did read a lot of it, didn't understand any of it, but the whole concept of going out there, getting involved in the game was the whole big thing,
yeah.
right? I started, my very first property was a rent-to-own, and then the whole idea of a rent-to-own, I basically...
Were you the tenant or the buyer? You bought it and rented it out to somebody?
Yeah, so I bought it. It was my first house,
yeah.
and then, you know, in that 2 or 3 year period, so I wasn't thinking private money back then. I was thinking, you know, how much can I save from my job for the next one? Yeah, and I ended up having to sell that house to move into, basically was a rent to own, lease option, whatever you want to call it, for this plaza in Sarnia. And it had 17 apartments in this plaza and a bunch of commercial. I had no money. Actually, it's a good thing that I didn't know what I was doing, because had I known, I never would have bought something so crazy.
Yeah.
Because I literally, it was, you know, several hundred thousand dollars that I had to spend in the first few years that I didn't have. So
yeah.
it was a lot of scrambling at the beginning, figuring out how to do things. Nowadays it'd be so easy because there's so many real estate groups, there's
yeah.
so many coaches everywhere, there's so much access to information now, so you know, I could just call anybody and said, hey, help me, what do I do here now? But back then I had no idea.
I think it's really funny because even though we have all this access to information today, almost nobody's taking full advantage of it. So you know, for all the people that would watch Matt's channel, we had 180,000 views, I think, in the last 28 days. Like, some absurd number, hundreds of thousands of views. And, like, 15 of those people reached out when we said, hey, we're looking for somebody to commit and come and work full time right beside Matt, right beside Adam, right beside the guys who are literally committing full on to this experience. And like, you kind of were like, wow, when I said the number of units, because I just got started, right? Mm-hmm. And so like, the only way I think you can do that is if you leverage that mentorship, you leverage the amount of information that's in front of you, but actually take action on it. So kind of like getting in the game was pretty big, right?
Well, you gotta be, I don't know, you gotta be self-motivated too, you know? Back then, I was sort of like, I had no choice. Once I've done this for a few years and I've built up a portfolio, the ambition, that same sort of feeling you had when you first started, it isn't there. It's something you have to work on every day, yeah. You know, because it sounds stupid, but it becomes a grind.
Yeah.
Right? You get, you know, your portfolio gets bigger and bigger and you're constantly in grow mode. Right?
Yeah.
So you have to be self-motivated. So I look back when I think, like guys your age, you know, it's amazing for me to watch. You know, again, back then we didn't have, you know, YouTube and all this stuff that we have now, social media.
Yeah.
I get to watch all you guys, you know, in your 20s and 30s,
yeah.
I get to watch you grow. Whereas
yeah.
back then, you know, we didn't have that.
Yeah.
So it's just awesome to watch all the young people that have decided that they're gonna take action, right? It took me many years before I took action. I was 35
that was
when
your
I
first
bought.
Deal?
Yeah.
Wow.
My first house when I was 35. You know, I was a renter for many years.
Yeah.
And I was a partier. You know, I knew every football team, every player, every hockey.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I was into when I was young.
Yeah.
And then at 35, I went, oh my God, I got to do something with my life. What do
yeah.
I do now? And then I got into real estate, and thank God I did. Right, it changed my life.
Yeah, I bet you're not upset that you made that move and had to struggle to find that money and then definitely force yourself to grow. So if you're back at my age, what would you start with? Because I know a lot of people, this is one thing that a lot of younger investors get hung up on is like, where do I start? How do I get started? And then there's always that question of like, should I buy single family? Should I buy multifamily? Should I try and get commercial? Should I try rent-to-own? Should I try this or that? And there's a million options. So you kind of get analysis paralysis there where you're like, wow, there's so many different things. Where do I start?
Well, I think you guys are doing exactly the way you should be. Again, access to information. So I would join a club. That's the first thing you do. And then at club meetings, you know, 1 week or 1 month, they have rent-to-own, they have a speaker that comes in. You know, get to know, get some books. That's another thing. And now there's, you know, back when I was doing this, there was only American content. Now there's actually quite a bit of Canadian content out there. There's Canadians, there's people in Ontario. There's quite a few successful people in Ontario, clubs, groups, coaches that you can go get information and then figure out through reading, going to groups, talking to people, you're going to get a sort of a feeling of what type of stuff you'd like to do, right? If you don't, no matter what strategy you decide to do, you're going to have to deal with people. There's
yeah.
no way around that. There's no sitting on your computer in the beach and
yeah.
flipping deals and all that stuff. That just doesn't happen. You're going to have to talk to people, right?
Dan, wait, are you saying that real estate's not a passive strategy?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Everybody gets stuck on this word passive all the time. This is something I find really funny. It's like, well, I wanted to build wealth and I wanted passive income. And then they learn that it's not passive. Like there's no passive element at all.
You have to work.
Yeah.
You know, you actually have to work,
yep.
and you have to be motivated, self-motivated. It's like anything else, right?
Join a club,
you know, get talking to people. You're going to find out what you actually enjoy.
Yep.
And for example, flipping houses is not for everybody.
Yeah.
It's sort of high risk, high reward. Maybe that's not something that you're into. Rent to own, no matter what strategy, they all have pros and cons.
Yeah.
And I would figure out what the pros and cons of each strategy are, and you're going to sort of have a feeling, a gut feeling of what direction you'd like to go.
Yeah.
And then once you've figured out, okay, this is something that I think I might be interested, go all in on that one thing and see how you do, right? Do one deal, and then you'll find out, you know, whether that's for you or not. And if it doesn't, maybe pivot. And maybe if you do get good at that one thing, I would recommend staying with that one thing. Don't try three different strategies at the same time. Just try to pick one thing, get good at that one thing, and then maybe go from there.
I think it's great that you say that, because that's something that Casey Wong actually said in one of the most popular videos on Matt's channel. Is he actually said, like, pick a strategy, stick with it, and stick with it over time. Like, if you think you can be successful at it and you're trying it and it is working out for you, why are you going now and chasing the next strategy, the next big thing? It's like, no, stick with a strategy that works, execute on it repeatedly, and then continue to grow in that space until you're, you know, a master at that, until you're ready to explore that next strategy. So I think that's really smart.
Yeah, I did, you know, like, I currently flip houses. I've been doing it now for about 4 years. And it was, like, I have a construction background. I did construction for 20 years. It was really difficult. There was a lot of aspects to that game that I had no idea was there.
Yep.
And it took years to finally, you know, get good at it. And I'm pretty good at it now. I'm still learning as I go. But any strategy is going to be like that. And I know, you know, it's now, again, with social media, I get to watch other experts, and I go, okay, right, you know, I can see that. Well, before social media, the only way you'd get to find out any of this information is you actually had to call that person and say, hey, let's meet, and you talk, and, you know, now we, it's you know, I'm so jealous.
Which I still think is super valuable, though. I think we're actually kind of circling back now to a time where people do really appreciate that face-to-face meeting, right? Where you can actually, again, this is going back to that thing about real estate and people. This is a people business. They're all people businesses. If you're gonna have tenants, that's a people business. If you're gonna have investors, that's a people business. If you're gonna try and sell your house to somebody else as a flipper, that's a people business. And I think that something that young investors might be missing out on right now is that actual piece where you have to reach out and talk to these people. You might have to offer them something like, hey, what would it take to get you an hour of your time, right? Can I buy you dinner? Can I buy you coffee? Can I buy you a beer? Doing those things are really important, I think, for people getting started out and getting into the room with people who are doing what you want to do, right? So if I want to know about flipping in Sarnia, I'm going to talk to Dan, right? If I want to know about flipping in London, I might be smarter off to talk to Sean Allen, right? And like these people that are experts in the field, and the only way you find out who those people are, the right people to talk to, is by being in those clubs, being in those networking groups, really surrounding yourself with those people who are actually already doing what you want to do. So I think that's great you're touching on all of these, because we have to leverage what's available to us today. And fortunately, there's a lot of resources online, in person, in every little city. Like, Sarnia is probably not on the map really for networking groups and all these things. However, we're all well familiar with Dan and with Corey from Sarnia and all of these people because they make it out online and they make it out in person to these different networking groups. So I think that's powerful.
It is a little scary. Admittedly, if you're not a people person, it could be very intimidating going to one of these groups. But, you know, you can just kind of hide out in the back of the room. Everybody's really friendly. They're going to go out of their way. And these, you know, because everybody in these groups all want to help each other. So I think just show up at one of these things. You'd be surprised, you know, who's going to come over and talk to you and say, hey, what's going on? And it's amazing that it's such a great community of people helping people. And, you know, it's just awesome. To be part of that.
All right, Dan, so you bought your first property at 35. How old are you today?
53.
And when did, so you're 53 today.
It's like 20 years.
18. So when did you start getting out there and networking? And like, when did that start to have an impact on your investing career? When did you start leveraging that?
Well, I'm still learning that part of it too, because I've only really been networking for the last few years. The first 15 years that I was doing this, I didn't even realize there was
that was a thing.
You know, I've only really discovered it, like I said, a few years ago. But it's actually made a huge impact now. I think, again, circling back to the access to information. Per se, as far as building my portfolio and all those kinds of things, it hasn't made that much of an impact now. I think I'm in the beginning stages of that.
Yeah.
But I'm noticing now that it takes years, it takes time, right? It doesn't, you just don't go to two or three meetings and all of a sudden everybody, the phone's ringing off the hook of, you know. So it takes years to develop these relationships, and now I'm starting, so the seeds I sown a few years ago are now starting to come up, and I'm like, wow, people who I had no idea were gonna reach out to me, say, hey Dan, I'm in Sarnia, let's meet up. I watched your video on YouTube and I think it's great. And I don't even realize that people are watching, right? Yeah. I'm not even noticing those things, but I know that people are watching, and you just got to get out there. It's going to take time, again, but it'll really change the trajectory of your career.
It's funny how small the world is too, because like when we first sat down, we were talking about how you were just on the phone with Corey this morning and like just chatting with him, and I wonder what that relationship even in and of itself has done for both of you, right? Just the ability to connect to somebody else in your market that's doing similar things and working on projects the same way you are, like it's just so great to be connected because you can shave so much time off. I mean, that was my strategy with getting so connected with Matt. Like, I learned 7 years of his mistakes in 1 year because all I did was ask him 1,000 questions and listen to every word he said. It was like gospel. I was like, this information is so valuable to me. And then immediately implementing that has allowed me to buy those 6 units in, you know, the span of probably 15 months or so of actual buying, which is amazing.
Well, you're lucky because you're immersed in it,
yes,
right? You guys are all immersed in this every day.
Yeah.
And it's like learning a language where I'm only going, you know, once a month to my 2-hour class, whereas you're living in that country and you're just thrown right into the deep end and you have to learn it.
Yeah.
So I'm a little jealous, you know, like again, when I first started out, you know, it's a very slow slog through learning, you know, weekly, monthly, all these things. You've had this massive crash course in a year or two. It's fantastic.
Well, the interesting thing is for the young investors that are watching or young would-be investors, there's always kind of the three things we talk about people having as a resource. You either have time, you have energy, or you have money, or some combination usually only of two of those things. So for most of the young people watching that want to get started, we probably have an abundance of time and energy. Not necessarily the money part, but for that time and energy, what can you do? Well, you can immerse yourself, right?
Yeah.
That's one of the things that we actually can do that you might not be as readily available to do at your age, right? At your place in the trajectory of your real estate career, or even your normal career as you were 35, right? You're starting to think about, you know, relationships, more personal relationships, potentially family. Okay, it's time to buy that house, right? Like, settle down a little bit, at least get established. Where like a lot of people watching might be in their early 20s right now or mid 20s and thinking like, holy shit, I got all this time, but I don't have the money, right? Or I don't have the knowledge or experience. And that's where we want to start leveraging those networking opportunities, the people that we know are already successful in this, so.
Yeah, I want a little piece of advice I'd give for young people starting out is I think one of the most important things that you have to learn is what is a deal.
Yeah,
I think that's because nothing happens until you have a deal.
Yep.
Right. You can go learn from, you know, the best guru. You can go to as many meetings as you can handle. You can do all that stuff. But to get started, you have to at least learn what is a deal. And find out that information. There's so much free information. There's, you know, you can't say that I can't afford it because there's just so much free information now.
Yeah.
Find out what a deal is. And then if you have lots of time and lots of energy, you can go practice. First, you can practice on paper what a good deal is, and then you can go out and actually implement and find a good deal and find two or three people from the club that you're going to and say, look, I've got this deal under contract. What do I do now? And
there'll be a lineup
of people there to help you. and get it out of your head that the people are going to take advantage of you or all these little stories that you hear. There's more people that want to help you than want to take your deal. So
I believe that wholeheartedly. Yeah. Like, this is a very giving community, a very receptive community, and for the most part, there's a lot of guys like Dan who you're fascinated that these younger guys are coming up and really actually trying to do something here.
It's great to watch. It's absolutely great to watch. Yeah, the veterans out there that are watching these young people that are, it's like sports, it's like anything else, right? Nice. You know, we're the veterans out there and we've been in the trenches for years. Yeah. And to see all the young people that are coming up now, that the timelines have shrunk so much.
Yeah.
What it took us 10 years to figure out, these guys are doing in one or two. And it's just awesome to watch. With social media, I get to watch it every day, right?
Yeah. And be a part of it.
It's
great giving back.
Want to see the video where I race Dan to the bottom of his water slides at his old abandoned water park? Check the video out up there. Otherwise, if you want more Dan Desveaux, we've got videos down here. And until next time, remember, making money is a team sport. There's more than enough money in this world for us to all make it, but if you're not saving it, I mean, like, what's the point, guys? Thanks.